Baseball has had a long tradition with statistics. Naturally, one way to get started is to understand the type of information that's on the back of baseball cards. And this gives us an initial appreciation of sabermetrics as it's known today, but baseball statistics as it's been known in the last 130 years. The tradition for baseball cards themselves have been around for a long time. One of the first baseball cards was printed in the 1880s, and King Kelly was a player coach for the Boston Bean Eaters, and eventually he was elected to the Hall of Fame for his very skilled base running and batting at the plate. So the point of learning how to read the back of a baseball card is to recognize what kind of information is on the back. And this gives us some insight into that individual player's performance and ability throughout their career. Secondly, I wanted to point out some interesting differences between baseball cards in the recent past and how they've changed compared to baseball cards 10 or 20 years ago. And finally, I want to focus on two types of statistics, some that are called rate statistics, which are essentially ratios, and others that are called counting statistics. And I'm going to show you examples of the two of them, but I want you to recognize that difference not only in baseball, but across all sports. You almost always have counting statistics, but you also can frequently see rate statistics. Now, you may be wondering, why am I starting with baseball in this course that's supposed to cover analytics in general? Several reasons. And as I mentioned before, baseball's been around for a long time. And fortunately, because of people who developed ways to capture that kind of information, we have over 100 years of data available. It's also very easy to determine who to credit an offensive or defensive play. Somebody gets credit for making an out, or somebody gets credit for creating a strikeout, or somebody gets credit for a home run. And this is much easier to assign that credit whenever there's a clear beginning and an end to a play. Not all sports follow that particular format. And finally, as a result of these first two reasons, the third reason has come about that the sabermetrics community, that is the community of baseball analysts, have their own professional society. They've created databases, which we can benefit from in this class, and also software to analyze some of this data. So this becomes extremely valuable to us. So let's look at a baseball card from the 1980s. So this is the kind of baseball card that I grew up looking at. And this was, of course, one of my favorite players, Tony Gwynn, who unfortunately passed away a few years ago. But he was inducted into the Baseball Hall of Fame, which is reserved to the top 1% of players. So it's already hard enough to get into the major leagues. It's even harder to get elected into the Hall of Fame. So what's pretty neat is that Tony Gwynn was really known for being a good hitter. He played in the outfield, so he could definitely run, and he could definitely hit. So this is evident by the statistic that is shown here called batting average. Batting average is actually a rate statistic, and it's the only rate statistic that exists on this card. All of the other numbers on here are what we consider to be count statistics, meaning that they are just the raw number. They are not divided by anything, they are not multiplied by anything, they are just straight counts. Okay, so I want to show you something in terms of how to calculate batting average. So let's focus on the batting average for the year 1984. And what's helpful is that this was actually his best year in the league, actually up to this point. And in 1984, San Diego Padres played in the World Series. So in order to calculate 351 as his batting average, you can actually follow this formula. Batting average equals hits divided by at-bats. So we look at the number of hits that Tony Gwynn had in that year. So that's 213. And we divide that by the number of at-bats. That's the number of official at-bats that he had at the plate. Okay, so 213 divided by 606. Let's work that out. 213 divided by 606. So you'll see that the answer is actually 6 significant digits. But in baseball, what happens is we only display the first 3. So this 351 is what's shown on his baseball card. 351. Okay, again, batting average is one of the ways that baseball players get evaluated, but because there is so much other data available, we also provide all of these counting statistics. Again, all of these are counting statistics. And then batting average is a rate statistic. Let's look at a more modern baseball card. This is Buster Posey, who is a catcher for the San Francisco Giants. Fantastic player. You'll notice a couple of differences between the Tony Gwynn baseball card and the Buster Posey baseball card. So this is already 30 years later. They start to look a little bit different. First of all, the order in which these things appear is a little bit different, and that's okay. The very similar statistics, just in slightly different order. But you'll notice that there are two new columns. One of them is called WAR. One of them is called OPS. Actually, there's three new columns, and the other one is called SLG for slugging. Okay. And so later I will discuss the formula for slugging. Let me just tell you that OPS is the sum of slugging plus on-base percentage. So that's why it's called OPS, on-base plus slugging. So it's the sum of two different numbers that are both rate statistics. Batting average, you recognize from before. Tony Gwynn's batting was very high. So was Buster Posey's. But then this new column is what I want to talk about next, which is WAR. WAR stands for wins above replacement. And wins above replacement is one of the new sabermetric statistics that people are tracking. And the reason this statistic was invented is because it was in the past very difficult to compare players to each other, based on the fact that most people were only looking at the counting statistics, which are all of these counting statistics, and sometimes they were looking at the rate statistic, in particular batting average. But this doesn't tell the whole story of how valuable a person is to their team. So they came up with this new statistic called wins above replacement in order to compare players to each other. So let me show you the formula for WAR, and then I'll come back to Buster Posey's baseball card. So again, the objective of WAR is to determine how valuable a player is for their team. And more specifically, as is noted here on the second bullet, if this player got injured and you had to replace them with a minor leaguer or an equivalent major leaguer who's sitting on the bench, how much value would the team be losing by making that replacement? Okay. Now here's the extended formula for WAR. And you'll see just from the fact that there is a division here, that there's a denominator and a numerator, already tells you that this is a rate statistic. Okay. Meaning that it's not a straight count. It is a rate statistic because there's something being divided by the number, in this case, the number of runs per win. So without getting into all the details, I just want to point out that war is a rate statistic that shows you relative to other players how much more valuable in terms of games, additional games that you're going to win by having this person on your roster. So, to give you a sense, in professional baseball, there are 162 games. So if somebody has a war score of 3.7, that means that over the course of the 162 game season, they are going to help you win 3.7 more games than the average player out there. And actually, in this case, than the average catcher out there, because war is calculated by position. So all the catchers are compared to each other, all the third basemen are compared to each other, all the outfielders, all the pitchers. So only people within the same position are compared to each other. So that's important to note. You'll see that Buster Posey's best year was 2012. He actually won the World Series that year. For with a war of 7.4. I mean, that is a phenomenal score, meaning that better than any other catcher in Major League Baseball, by having Buster Posey on your roster, you were going to win 7.4 more games than the average catcher out there. Now, here's actually an interesting summary of the ranges for war scores. So what the folks at fangraphs.com have to say is that if a player has a war of from 0 to 1, that means they're not very valuable. In other words, they're a scrub. And in fact, you'll see from the data on the right that it is actually possible to have a negative war score, as these couple hundred players do. So anything below 0, you'll see that these guys have a negative war score, meaning that they are worse than the average player. And then when as you look up this way on the left part of the graph, you'll see that the highest war score in this case for the year 2010 was 8, meaning that that particular player would help you win 8 more games throughout the 162 game season. Now, looking back at Buster Posey, you'll notice that he had one year where he had a negative war score, so that's not good. His second lowest year was 1.4. That's okay, but every other year he had a phenomenal 3.7, 5.2, 7.4. I mean, that's a phenomenal role player, all-star, superstar, and even MVP caliber player. So this is a much more sophisticated way of comparing players to each other, and it allows us to compare catchers to other catchers, infielders to other infielders, and pitchers to other pitchers. So it's a more equitable way to compare players to each other and determine, hey, if I want to trade one player for another, how do they compare to each other in terms of war? And I'm going to show you a website which I thought was very interesting. There's actually a war calculator, and what they do is they take all of the inputs for the war formula, on-base percentage, slugging percentage, average on-base percentage, average. So these are the average of the other players in the league, and they want to know how much better you are than the average player in the league in that position. And then there's a position adjustment factor. The number of games that you play also matters a lot. And then there's some sort of judgment of how good your defense and your base running is. And so this little war calculator, you enter information for the particular player you're trying to evaluate. And this actually only works for a given year. And then at the end, it gives you a war score for that player. In this case, this example is a war of 2. And then it says, well, if this player has a war value of 2, the value of that player is $9 million on your roster. I mean, that's a phenomenal, very quick way of getting a numerical value in terms of salary assigned to a player. And actually, the performance of a player is extremely sensitive to their war score and their value. Let me give you an example. So say that I change this number from 0.340 to 0.4. Before I hit enter, I want you to notice that the value for this player is $9 million. The moment that I hit enter, it should recalculate. It didn't. It's not working. So theoretically, this particular player should have had a higher war score. Let me refresh this website and see if maybe that's the issue. Okay, so 0.340, I'm going to change that to 0.4. Here we go, it worked. So it moved from $9 million and it increased their value to $14.9 million just in a small change in their on-base percentage. So this is a nice way to kind of play around with the numbers and see how sensitive any changes in this column are going to create in terms of the value, the war score, and the value of that player. Okay, I'm going to give you a little bonus challenge for anybody who wants to work this. This solidifies your understanding of the rate measures and the counting measures. So you'll notice that for the row that says career, in basically all of these cases for the counting measures, the number in this row is the sum of the numbers above it. So 60 strikeouts is the sum of these three numbers. 96 walks is the sum of these three numbers. 48 steals is the sum of these three numbers. So on and so forth. Now, if I was to look at Tony Gwynn's career batting average is 329. I'm wondering how did we get that? Because if I take these three numbers and I average them, again, I would have to average them because they're rate scores. If I average them, I don't get 329. I get a different number. So my question to you as a bonus challenge is, how did they get 329? If it's not the average of these three numbers, then what is it? I'll leave you with that. And if you can figure out the answer, send me an email and I will give you some sort of prize, some bonus points, something. All right, take care.